Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, I'm very happy to be here, and I would like to talk to you about a technology which is quite old, riverbank filtration, but has been used in Germany for more than 140 years. But at first, I would like to acknowledge my co-authors, my PhD students from Germany, and the many Egyptian partners, especially from the holding company for water and wastewater, and from the universities in Egypt, which have in some way contributed to adjust the concept for the application of riverbank filtration in Egypt. So first, the definition. So if you install a well near to a river or a lake, you create a drawdown, you create a hydraulic gradient, so you will get a water flow from the river towards the well. And of course, it's mixed with some landside groundwater and maybe even groundwater coming beneath the river towards your well. There are many processes occurring in the aquifer, so it's especially the filtration, which is important for the removal of pathogens, but also redox reactions and adsorption and chemical reactions. But it's not new, so it's very old, and the first literature we have found was from 1798, so it's more than 200 years old, and this was the first drawing of a site which could be named the riverbank filtration site. So it doesn't matter if you say riverbed filtration or canal bed filtration. Normally the filtration occurs across the boundary between the aquifer and the river or the surface water body. And it is depending on the site where is the major filtration happening. But even this is a very old example, but we will see a few newer ones. There's a vision of using riverbank filtration in Egypt. So these dots are only indicating some existing sites and the planned sites. So I think maybe in total you have already 40 small-scale riverbank filtration sites in Egypt, but it's still less than 1% of the total water production based on bank filtration. If you compare this with a European country like Germany, we have about 8% based on bank filtration, still used, even if it's already more than 100 years old. So it's also a good indication for sustainability of the technology. And in Hungary, for example, which is also a very flat country, which has a big river like the Nile, so they have a Danube, they are based to 50% on riverbank filtration. So they do not abstract surface water, they go for bank filtration. And bank filtration offers many advantages. A few are highlighted here, especially the pathogen removal. It's not only about bacteria, it's also very effective to remove viruses and protozoa. It's about pollutant removal, it's about buffering, equilibration of concentration, and this all for low cost. So it's a natural pre-treatment. If you are lucky, you even have to do a disinfection step, but not more. But very often you have anoxic conditions, so you may go for iron and manganese removal afterwards. If you plan such a riverbank filtration site, so it looks quite easy, but there are many things that have to be taken into account. So it needs some time and it needs some budget. And this is something the companies don't want to spend. So you should spend some money before you install the real abstraction wells. It's very important to find the optimal operation and design for the scheme. And there are no general handbooks or guidelines available because it's very much depending on the local site conditions, so it's quite difficult to generalize things. So if you like to find a new site for your well, you can go for such type of methods, but maybe it's not the best one. So you can also have a phased approach for the design, and you should first identify the objectives. What would you like to have? The second is the feasibility assessment of your selected site. And there is a new study recently published by the UN Habitat. It's now available, and it's already about the feasibility of riverbank filtration in Egypt. And you should go for some field investigations for the system installation and not forget the monitoring to to adjust your operation. And if you start with objectives, you first have to say if you like to have a high percentage of bank filtrate or not. So you may get more than 50% bank filtrate. You may like to have a very strong removal of pathogens. Or on the other hand, you may like to have a removal of micropollutants. So if you only want to remove turbidity and pathogens, there may be a short distance sufficient between the riverbank and the well. If you like to remove micropollutants, you need more distance, a longer travel time, a larger reaction volume in the aquifer. And of course, this is affected by the geomorphology, by the different layers in the subsurface, so the hydrogeology, water quality, and then you can adjust distance and travel time. One issue in Egypt is that, not only in Egypt, in many countries where you have alluvial deposits, is that you find groundwater which has elevated concentrations in iron and manganese. And normally the groundwater has a higher concentration than the river water. And if you place a well, and you also abstract some landside groundwater. So if you place a well on an island where you get mainly bank filtrate, there may be a little problem with iron manganese, but you may not find an island everywhere. So you have to keep into account that you have to touch also the groundwater portion. And it's important to think about the distance between the well, which is a dot here indicated beside the river. And if you have a well which is pumping a low amount of water, or which is quite far from the river, as you see on the right-hand side, then you may not get even river water, you mainly get groundwater. Even the groundwater is passing by your well and it's coming back. So the portion of bank filtrate may be very low. So if you go near to the river, then your portion is higher, but the removal rate may be lower. So it's a question of optimization. If you go to the site, you first have a site assessment. You have to bring some equipment to get some parameters. Also, it's a basis for the modeling then. So you should go for a simple groundwater flow modeling. That's normally a student from a civil engineering department should be able to do that. And you can come out with a prediction of a travel time, with a portion of bank filtrate, and with a delineation of the catchment zones. For example, if you have a river like the Nile, which is cutting it through the clay, so you may have different branches or different parts of the river which is in contact with the aquifer, and then it may have a less hydraulic conductivity in some parts. So if you construct a well on the right-hand side of the river here, you may get less bank filtrate because there's clogging of the riverbed. If you put it on the left-hand side, there may be a better option. So you need the riverbed elevation and the boundary between the clay layer and the aquifer, which could be used for water abstraction. So it's very important that the river really penetrates into the aquifer, otherwise it doesn't make sense to go for bank filtration. So that's why it's mainly feasible in Upper Egypt, because in the Delta region or north of Cairo, you have very often the case that the Nile is not cutting through the clay layer. If you want to have a high portion of bank filtrate, you may, for example, go to an island, which is case A. You may go to a meander, because there's a natural groundwater or natural river infiltration already before you start pumping, so you have higher rates of bank filtration. Or you may go between the old branch and the actual river course. So the place, if you place the wells there, you have the highest portion of bank filtration, and maybe less problems with iron and manganese. Then you have to talk about riverbed conditions. So your flow velocity is not that high, but you should look for branches where you may have less width of a river, so higher flow velocity, more shear stress. And you should go for infiltration rates which are not too high to prevent clogging. So this number is just the result of checking the old sites in Europe, but it could be a task for a student here in Egypt to check if this is applicable to the Nile River or not. So it's about the 0.2 cubic meters infiltration per square meter riverbed and day. Of course, you have to look at the river water quality, but for the Nile River, I think it's very good. because it's feasible for bank filtration. You have not such high concentration of micropollutants. You have a very nice bioreactor already in the river. You have a very low concentration of biodegradable organic carbon, which would cause anoxic conditions. So you may be happy to even have no iron manganese released during your aquifer passage. But important is to have a riverbed which is not blocked by fine sediments, which are organically rich, so because they can also consume oxygen if you increase the infiltration. So you can go for initial site assessment. This is an example from India. You see the well is located in a meander, so we have a higher portion of bank filtrate, longer flow paths. So you should do some borehole logs. You should make some test bores, a pumping test for the first abstraction well, do the water quality tests, and then you protocol everything and you come up with a proposal for the water company. This has been done also in Egypt, and it was even including diving, so that we took riverbed sediments from the Nile River. So it's quite useful to know something about the sediments on top of a river bottom, and you make sieving analysis and so on to get the hydraulic conductivity. And the riverbed clogging is very important because it could block the riverbed totally so that you don't get any more bank filtrate. And so you may not go to that site where you have already sedimentation of fines because they may create a very low hydraulic conductivity of a riverbed. When you install a monitoring infrastructure so that you really observe if this site is working properly, and it's about river aquifer connection, and you should think about even spend some money for data loggers for water level measurements continuously. And it's good to have a pilot well at a short distance to the river, and if you could convince a company to spend some more money, it would be helpful to have even one or two observation wells between the well, the production well, and the river bank. There are some materials available also from investigations in other countries. I will not go into the detail here, but there is already a phased approach with different stages which can be followed in the literature. So a brief summary on the site evaluation. You should look at the water levels, the drawdown and proportion of bank filtrate. You should check the water quality, especially also what could happen due to the mixing with landside groundwater. And then you can make a groundwater flow model to find the best place for your wells, that you have a maximum, for example, bank filtrate and a good quality. And then you should go for a water safety plan and even make your wells flood-proof. So the appropriate conditions for bank filtrations are fully there in Upper Egypt. So we have a continuous river flow, we have a sand and gravel riverbed. You could go for low infiltration rates because you have a large width of your river. You have nice sand and gravel aquifers, and the thickness is much more than 10 meters at most places. So there are many places feasible for bank filtration in Egypt. So at the end, I would like to show you a few case studies. So one is from Germany, very simple. You see there at the river on the right-hand side, this small shaft. This is a well used for industrial water supply. And they use the water in a quarry to get less dust in the quarry, and because they cannot use the river water because it contains pathogens and the people would inhale it. So they use bank filtrate and they are very safe with that. There is another type of abstraction in Jordan here for agriculture. If you irrigate your crops with river water, you may also distribute or spray the pathogens on your salad, which you sell on the market. But if you have a well which is very near to the river, you may already have a removal of pathogens and you can use safe irrigation water. There was a site in the canal at Birkesh in Egypt where they also pumped water from a deeper layer, and they thought it was bank filtrate, but it was just groundwater because the river there or the canal there is not cutting through the clay layer. So this was a case where there was no bank filtrate. But you would see it from the fluctuations, comparing the fluctuations of the water pressure in the well and in the canal, and maybe also to temperature measurements and some other water quality parameters. So there's nice water, but this water is groundwater only. Another case was in Dishna in Egypt. You have here a waterworks site and a pilot site, and there was a well constructed to get bank filtrate. Everything was done properly. And when they have installed the data loggers for water level, and you see the upper light, the dotted line, is from the canal. So the canal was in the north of the site, and this has a higher water level than the Nile. So the groundwater is flowing from the canal towards the River Nile and has quite a high gradient. And then you see these black lines. So this should be the lower line, because this would be then the drawdown in the well. But if there is such a fluctuation, it indicates that they have switched off the well every day. So the people at the site thought that the pump needs to have some sleep at night. But the pump is not a human, a pump is a machine. So you should give the machine the right to operate continuously. Don't switch off the pumps. Don't operate your pumps 20 hours or 22 hours a day. Let them run for 24 hours, which is much better. And then you would also get bank filtrate, because if you switch off the pumps, the groundwater will flow over your well and you will never get bank filtrate. So this is the case here. So if you have continuous operation, Q is constant, then you would have bank filtrate from the River Nile. But if you have an intermittent operation of a well, then you have very low infiltration of river water. You mainly have groundwater, which may have high manganese and iron. There are other sites which have not worked very well. It's one in Korea. They have constructed a very nice horizontal collector well. It was impressive. They spent much money, but they closed the well after a few days because they didn't think about the site. This site is downstream of a wastewater treatment plant, and it had a water quality of more than 10 milligram of ammonium in the river water. If you have such high ammonium concentration, you cannot go for bank filtrate, because you will get so much iron and manganese, there's no chance. The last example of the suggestion is that you should also think about this type of old system, the siphon system, which saves up to 50% of energy if you connect all the wells to a collector well and not to install a pump in each well separately. So you just have a so-called siphon system. And there could be a demonstration project maybe on one side in Upper Egypt in the future. You may make your wells flood-proof. You should have it at a higher elevation. I think at the Nile you don't need that elevation, like here. You are in a flat valley. But you should think also about to run the wells even if you have a flood. And it can be even if you have a normal well chamber, it can be checked if everything is properly sealed with easy instruments. So this it can prove that your well is even properly sealed to be operated during a flood.